Okay, so first of all, good afternoon, everybody, and thanks, Massimiliano, for the nice introduction. And in this talk, I would like to present some of the new features available in Abinit to compute Phonon-limited transport properties. I will mainly focus on the Boltzmann transport equation, but I will also introduce some basic concepts and approximation, and I will try to establish a connection with the other talks by Guillaume and Joao, in which they will be presenting additional developments and results for transport properties. First of all, I would like to stress that transport is an out of equilibrium phenomenon in the sense that we perturb the system that is initially in the thermodynamic equilibrium by applying fields such as the electric field or the temperature gradient. The system reacts to this perturbation. We have an initial phase in which the macroscopic properties evolve in time. This is called the transient part, and we are not interested in this region. And after a certain time interval, the system reaches the so-called steady state in which the macroscopic quantities do not change in time. Although at the microscopic level, what happens is that the scattering events fully counteract the action of the fields, and we reach this steady state. We are also interested in the linear regime. So we want to understand how the electric current density and the heat current density are related to the fields. Obviously, we are in the linear regime, so everything can be expressed in terms of this linear operator in which each block is a 3 by 3 tensor with the symmetry of the point group of the crystal. And these quantities can depend on the magnetic field, the temperature, but they do not depend on the perturbation. So this is the expression that you usually find in textbooks for theoretical derivation. But when comparing with experiments, one has different settings and different boundary conditions. So in experiments, usually one reformulates this equation in terms of other transport tensors, in particular the conductivity and the Seebeck coefficient, if we focus on the electric part. I won't be discussing the thermal part because it requires some special treatment for phonons. And in particular, most of the questions will be dealing with the computation of the conductivity. Now, before starting, there are two different approaches that I usually use to tackle the transport problem. The first one is based on non-equilibrium Green's function, so it's a fully quantum mechanical treatment, and the conductivity sigma can be expressed by the cube equation in terms of the spectral function A. In my talk, I will be mainly focusing on the Boltzmann transport equation, but it's important to understand that there are different approaches. What is available inside Abinit? First of all, I would like to stress that there are two different implementations. The one provided by AnaDDB, that is a post-processing tool in which we read the electron phonometric elements produced by the DFT code. Then we have another implementation that is directly integrated with Abinit. We have seen in the previous talk that if you're interested in metals, we can use the Allen's approach, so the variational method plus this expansion to compute Seebeck and conductivity in metals. If we use the Abinit version, then we can handle metals as well as semiconductors, but with a different approach that does not rely on this variational technique and the basis set. Some results for metals, as well as some important techniques needed for semiconductors, are discussed by Guillaume in the next talk. Some results for different approximation. And I will try to clarify the meaning of these terms in the next slides. In principle, Abinit can also compute the cube equation from the spectral function. The problem is that in order to get a decent spectral function, we have to include high order electron phonon diagrams. And this is the topic that will be discussed by Joao in his talk on the cumulant expansion. As now, a couple of words on the Boltzmann transport equation. First of all, it's a semi-classical technique of formalism that is based on two assumptions. First of all, we assume that the electronic properties can be described with the block band picture. What does it mean? That from the many-body perspective, we have a spectral function that is strongly peaked around the quasi-particle excitation. Moreover, we assume that these quasi-particle states form wave packets that, in the absence of scattering events, evolve in time according to the semi-classical equation, where we have the group velocity here and the standard electromagnetic force that determines a variation in time of the quasi-momentum k. Now, the fundamental object of the Boltzmann formalism is the distribution function f for the out-of-equilibrium state, the steady state in particular. This object here, once multiplied by this infinitesimal volume, gives us the number of particles occupying this region at time t. And in the absence of fields, f reduces to the standard Fermi-Dirac distribution. Now, the Boltzmann equation is essentially a conservation equation for the particle flow, because if you focus on the evolution from t minus dt, dt is an infinitesimal interval, and we go to time t, what we can say is that the number of particles that we find in this region of the phase space must be equal to the number of particles that are driven by the semi-classical dynamics. Here we have the value indeed at t minus dt, plus an additional term that takes into account all the particles that are entering or leaving this state due to the microscopic scattering events. Now, if you start from this conservation equation, you use Taylor expansion, you arrange a bit the terms, you get the Boltzmann equation. You still have this time derivative, but since we are not interested in the transient, we can neglect it. Now, once we have solved this equation for f, we can express the current densities in terms of the occupation functions of the out of the equilibrium distribution, the group velocities, and then for the thermal part, we need the chemical potential. Obviously, the previous equation is difficult to solve, so we start to introduce some approximation. The first one is related to the fact that we are studying everything in the linear regime, so fields are small, and we can seek a solution in the form of a correction to the Fermi-Dirac equilibrium function. This is our unknown quantity that is linear in the field, and only this term contributes to the current densities. By the same token, we have to linearize also the scattering integral. This is just a Taylor-like expansion for functionals. The constant here is zero because f0 is a solution of the Boltzmann equation at zero fields, and we are left with this operator that is essentially a linear functional of the correction delta f. Now, I spare you all the mathematical, passages, but at the end of the day, what we get is this linearized Boltzmann equation that represents our starting point for further approximations. Now, so far, we haven't discussed the microscopic nature of the scattering operator. In principle, one should include all the possible events. In particular, we have electron phonon scattering, one phonon, multiple phonons, as well as electron-electron interaction, scattering with defects, and ionized impurities. And this contribution is very important in doped semiconductors. We should also include the scattering with grain boundaries and other mechanisms, including high-order terms. Obviously, this complicates significantly the mathematical problem. So to make life easier, we start to introduce additional assumptions. We focus on zero field settings, and we'll include electron phonon scattering with one phonon because it's well known that this is the dominant term at room temperature. Also, the other terms sum up, they have some temperature dependence, but this is something that we can deal with, and it's a significant term. This is the standard electron phonon Hamiltonian with the electron phonon matrix elements that can be computed with the Konesham DFPT. Now, another point that I would like to stress at this level is that in principle, one should have another equation for phonons. Electrons and phonons are coupled, so these two equations are coupled, and phonons scatter through non-anharmonic terms. So to make life easier, we completely neglect this second equation, we assume that phonons are in equilibrium. But it's important to include this equation for the thermal part. Now, if we start from the previous electron phonon interaction Hamiltonian, we use Fermi's golden rule, we obtain the following expression for the total electron phonon scattering operator. Note that here we have two delta functions that are enforcing energy conservation for the electron phonon scattering process. And these two coefficients, P minus and P plus, are related to the occupancy for electrons and phonons. Here you have essentially the exclusion principle in action, and then NQ plus one is associated to phonon emission, and Q is associated to phonon absorption. And here I'm schematically depicting these four processes using this figure from this paper. Note that all the terms have a sign depending whether the electrons are entering or leaving the NK state. This is the full scattering operator. We have to linearize it. I spare you all the mathematical details. And the final result is that the linearized operator is essentially the sum of two terms. The first one is the so-called relaxation time approximation. The physical interpretation is relatively simple. You are in the steady state, you switch off the fields, and the carriers go back to the thermodynamic equilibrium with an exponential decay and time constant tau zero. Then we have another term that is much more complicated because it's a functional of delta F. If you look at the expression of these two guys in terms of microscopic ingredients, what we found is that tau zero is related to the imaginary part of the Fanny-Gdal self-energy that is computed in this particular case. The second term is much more complicated to build, and then I will discuss how Abinit handles the construction of this term. For the time being, I'm mainly interested in understanding how to simplify even further these equations. And so I introduced two approximations that are commonly used in the literature. In the so-called certa approximation, one completely neglects the second term and we end up with this simple expression. The nice thing is that equations are easy to solve. You can get an explicit expression for the linear correction, and also transport tensors are very easy to compute in terms of these ingredients. But strictly speaking, tau zero represents the lifetime of a charged excitation. It cannot be directly related to a transport lifetime unless you assume the set approximation. The other approximation is the MRTA, that stands for momentum relaxation time approximation, in which one tries to partially account for this term by just introducing this efficiency factor that dumps scattering events with a small momentum transfer, because these events are not supposed to deteriorate the electric current. Now, there are some qualitative arguments that tell us that the MRTA approximation is expected to be better, but here, for better, I mean something that is closer to the exact solution. So the question is, how do we solve the exact the Boltzmann equation? Obviously, we have to focus on some simple problem. So again, zero magnetic field, no temperature gradient, only electric field spatially constant. We write the correction in terms of the scalar electric field times an unknown quantity. After some manipulations, we can rewrite the Boltzmann equation in terms of a system of linear equations. This matrix in principle is huge because we need a lot of Q points to converge the calculation, but thanks to the presence of these two delta functions, the matrix is sparse and we can use iterative techniques to solve the problem. Once you have F, then you can compute the conductivity using this expression. At the level of the implementation, solving the IBT requires the inclusion, the specification of this variable in the input file plus the standard certa run. The algorithm is IO bound in the sense that in order to construct the functional, we have to write some data to the netcdf file. So if you have a machine with a very bad IO, the IBT can be twice slower than the certa. But we can use symmetries, the tetrahedron method, to reduce the memory saved on file. And last but not least, the solver is relatively fast. There are new variables. Okay, this is the most important one to activate IBT. If you want to solve the IBT starting from the CDPH file, you can use these two options. And these other three variables are essentially related to the iterative eigenvalue solver. Some final results. We are performing calculation for semiconductors and metals. And here I'm showing the results for silicon and gallium arsenide because these are well-known systems that have been reported in the literature. What we have observed so far is that silicon is the exception, is the typical case in which whatever you do, you get something that makes sense, because the CERTA is relatively close to the exact solution. The MRTA is doing a great job in reproducing the exact results. But if you look at the more complicated case of gallium arsenide, what we observe is that CERTA is strongly underestimating the exact results, although it is in reasonable agreement with the experiments. The other behavior that we are observing is that the momentum and relaxation time, as well as the IBT, require more K points and Q points to converge. And that solving the IBT equation does not necessarily improve the agreement with the experiment. But in my opinion, this is not unexpected, in the sense that there are several approximations that are involved in the formalism. First of all, we approximate in a quasi-particle energy with Cohn-Sham. It's very well known that spin-orbit coupling should be included, especially for holes, but on the other hand, we should also include many body effects due to electron-electron-electron phonon interaction. It's also well known that electron phonon matrix elements computed at the Cohn-Sham level are underestimated due to the Cohn-Sham band gap problem. There are some systems in which phonons should be renormalized if we have an instability at finite temperature. In principle, one should solve a system of two coupled Boltzmann equation for phonons and electrons, and phonon drag can have also an impact on the conductivity and the Seebeck coefficient. And last but not least, also the comparison with experiment is tricky, because one should include the effect of ionized impurities either through models or initial techniques. In experiment, usually they probe all mobilities, and this required some extension of the formalism to include the magnetic field. And also the experimental values are usually scattered because the quality of the sample strongly affects the electronic conductivity. So this is the last slide of my talk. I thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to answer your questions.
Thanks, Matteo. That was really impressive, the amount of information you were able to convey in 20 minutes. there is a question from Felix Goudreau asking whether IBT has been implemented for metals as well. And also, is there any plans for implementation with B different from zero? Is that a magnetic field? Mm-hmm. I guess. How to account for a temperature gradient with an infinite crystal? So there are three questions, actually.
That's a good question. Okay, let's start from the first part. Is there any plans for metals? Yes, metals are implemented. I run some calculation for lithium and aluminium. There's still some testing that must be done, but I'm confident that everything is already in place. And yes, we plan to add support for finite magnetic field, because we are interested in all mobilities. Well, the modifications are not that difficult. And how to account for temperature gradient? Great question. I would say Fourier expansion. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or something like Max's formalism to do.
Sure. But yeah, now in my to-do list, I have a lot of, let's say, things that should be improved, including also the computation of the Seebeck at the IBT level. Because in one of my slides, I was mentioning that, the relaxation time approximation, there's no difference between the L11, L12 terms. But if you go to IBTE, if you want to solve the equation with the zero electric field and temperature, a finite temperature gradient, spatially constant, then you have a different equation, a slightly different equation. So this requires some additional coding. And this is something that I would like to investigate before going to, spatially dependent fields.
Okay. So very quickly, there are two questions also by Michel Côté. He's asking whether there are AbiPi tutorials for these calculations and how your results compare to those of Bin.
Ah, Okay, great question. Okay, concerning the IBPI tutorials, Guillaume is going to show some examples. So he wrote some scripts to automate the computation of mobilities in semiconductors. There's also some implementation by Olivier. So yes, the answer is yes. We have examples. The level of tutorials, perhaps we have to write some notebook to explain how to run the different steps. At present, the official documentation is the standard Abinit tutorial. But we plan that mentions how to use IBPI to post-process the data. But we plan also to write some tutorial to explain how to run stuff. And then how do the meta results compare to those of BIN? That's a very good question. Because we perform some comparison. The results are not really on top of each other, but they are relatively close, although we are using two different formalisms. We still have to perform additional tests. What I observed is that the IBT is more problematic to converge at low T with respect to the LOVA, with respect to the variational approximation.